So good morning, everyone. I'm here to present, to start a presentation for the MICRA project, and I would introduce it by a brief motivation, the motivation that led to the development of the project. So basically, in the last years, all the nations strive to reduce their emissions and their energy consumption in the energy field. For example, in Europe, the policy package, the EU 2020, imposed to all the countries of the European Union to reduce their greenhouse gases emission by 20% and increase the efficiency of their energy-related machines by 20%. So for this reason, many companies have analyzed the market in order to find a window to invest and produce machines that are able to produce energy for resident, for the residential sector in an innovative way. Why the residential sector? Basically because the residential sector accounts for 1/3 of the share of the total energy consumption globally. So they come up with this new concept, the concept of micro cogeneration or micro CHP, which allows the reduction of the greenhouse gases emissions, because actually for the same amount of energy produced, both thermal and electrical, this is the great feature of the cogeneration, for the same amount of energy produced, it consumes less primary energy, so the fuel, and has higher efficiency when compared to the traditional way of producing energy. Furthermore, we have the reduction of the transmission losses for what concerns electricity, and the fact that these machines are actually more efficient than the traditional boilers, which are less tightly regulated. In this landscape, AsjaGen came out with a machine, which is a cogenerator, which is the tandem, which has been used for big residential applications such as restaurants, hotels, and stuff like that. So what she wanted us to do, what the company wanted us to do, was to investigate the market and come up with the best suitable solution for going to small-scale residential application. What does this mean, small scale? Small scale basically means moving from big residential buildings such as hotels or big block of flats to independent houses, monofamiliar flats, so like 3-4 people living in one let's say residential unit. So the aim of the MICRA project is to find an innovative energy supply solution for this small residential application. How we did this was starting from a stakeholder and requirements analysis to understand which were the needs both of the company and of the potential users of this machine, of this new technology. After that, we made a thorough state-of-the-art analysis of the present technology to understand and to assess which one was the most suitable one, and to go deepen and analyze only those who were actually qualitatively suitable for our purpose. Having selected this, so after a pre-screening, we started a techno-economical assay of this machine by developing both energetic and economic simplified model through a MATLAB script we have done. After using this MATLAB script that was developed with the sole purpose of going on with this analysis, we came out with some numbers, so some results that we could actually feed to a multi-criteria analysis. So we developed a multi-criteria scheme. We developed a criteria scheme thanks to the requirements of the stakeholders and these results we've obtained, mixed it together and came up with the final solution, let's say. It is important to stress that this final solution, so the final outcome of this analysis, is not the main point of our project. The main point of our project is the development of the tool, a tool which is capable, as I said, of doing simplified, energetic, and economic analysis for this type of machines, and allows a user, potential user, whoever it is, for example, companies, to make fast and comparative analysis of different technologies simply by changing the input data.
All right, moving forward from where my colleague just stopped, We consider three different stakeholders for our analysis. First of all is the AsjaGen, the company involved promoting the project. And then we have our end users, the final users of this project, of the device, and then of course the authorities that set the framework on the political of course wheel, the policies and all the international agreements necessary for us to operate, for the emissions and also for the noise. Now, the requirements from these different stakeholders were grouped into four categories. First, we have the human-based requirement. A typical example is the usability of our device, replacing the regular boilers and the grids currently being used right now. And of course, we have the technical or functional part of the requirements, which of course has installed the safety, the power, the efficiency, and all of that. Then we have the business part of the requirements. Now, the business has to do with the cost. For AsjaGen, they are interested in selling their device and making profit. And of course, the users are interested in buying this device at a good price. And of course, getting efficient supply of power and electricity. Also for the regulations and the policies, like I said earlier, these are based on the authorities, the framework, the limits, the boundaries, the standards within which we operated. Now, looking at this slide, you notice that there's a clustering of these different requirements. Now, a typical example is, take for example the pollution emission. Now, you notice that the pollution emission would involve both AsjaGen as a company and the regulators. So we have these two stakeholders, interwoven in, clustered for us to have a good emission standard. And then of course, another example is the noise. The noise involves three different stakeholders. First of all, the users, the AsjaGen, and then of course the regulators. So the clustering of these different requirements produced and was used later on for our multi-criteria analysis, which was used to come out with a solution. Now, moving forward, this is just a simple schematic to describe how the machine operates. First, you have the inlet gas or fuel, whichever fuel it is, going into our CHP device, and then, of course, it generates the electricity used for our appliances in the house and also for heat. Now, in comparison with our standard, which you currently use right now, the standard boilers and the grid. Now, two basic things are considered. First, the environmental impact. From our analysis, we realized that using the CHP device would reduce the emissions from about 8 to 44%, which is really very huge, and meeting the vision of European Union, which was earlier talked about by my colleague. Also, that there is the smart solution by our CHP device, which is based on the intrinsic thermodynamic property of the device. Now, take an example, this schematic we have here. We have our CHP device, 100 units of inlet fuel going into our CHP device and producing 30 units of electricity and 60 units of heat. Now, for us to have exactly the same amount using our standard boilers, you require some more, total of about 141.7 thereabouts units. So using the CHP actually saves us about 29%, which is really very huge. Finally, before I move on, I hand over to my colleague, we consider the cost. This is important for AsjaGen and as well the users. Now, like every other technology, the more we produce, the more we increase the units of our production, the lesser the price. So this is just a little analysis to describe that, and the figures are all there. So I'll hand over to my colleague to continue from here.
Thank you, Gareth. So as for the state-of-the-art analysis, we have looked and read through a large number of papers, and we have searched for the main commercially available at the present moment products in order to gather as more as possible reliable data to use as input for our further calculations. So from a preliminary screening, we have decided not to consider organic Rankine cycles because of too low electrical efficiency, just single digit. And we have chosen not to consider the microturbines because they are in the very, very earliest research phase for 1 kilowatt power size, so there are no reliable data. In the following slides, we present the main cons and the pros of our three candidate technologies in order to give you a broad picture. So the Stirling engine is an external combustion engine type, which means that the combustion takes place outside of the chamber where the working gas is. This allows us to have a large variety of possible energy sources, which can be fossil fuels as oil or natural gas, and renewable fuels, for example, thermal solar or biomass. Since the combustion is external, it is also more continuous with respect to internal combustion engines, and its efficiency is higher. So we have lower emissions, and this allows us to meet the 2020 EU policy package, so it's a very important feature. The frictions and the mechanical contacts are minimized, so the vibration and noise level are also reduced, and this is very important since we have to install our system in a residential domestic application. The maintenance intervals are also longer, and this allows us to have lower operating and maintenance costs. But what is the main issue? The main issue is that data we have are based on a limited number of demonstration projects worldwide at the present moment. So we need more operating and testing hours in order to get more reliable data. And furthermore, since we are in the first research phase, the costs are very high at the moment for the selling engines, and this accounts also for the fuel cells. But as we have seen before, since we are in the very research phase, improvements are expected and therefore reduction costs in the next years. The internal combustion engines are at the present moment the most developed technology, the well-established ones, so they have the lowest installed costs, the performance and economic data are well known, and they have the highest availability during the year. But the other two technologies have the potential to beat them in this matter. They produce, since the combustion is internal, the highest emissions. They also have the highest maintenance costs because they require more periodic maintenance, and they have the highest noise level because of the internal combustion. So this brings us to the fuel cells, which involve the reaction among hydrogen and oxygen in the presence of an electrolytic. So they produce electricity without any combustion and any mechanical work. And this is very important because it allows us to have the lowest emissions of the three candidates, the highest electrical efficiency, which can reach up to 60%, and since there is no mechanical work, no moving parts, so the maintenance costs are reduced as well as the noise level, so this is another important advantage. They can be fueled not only by hydrogen, but also by natural gas, and for their module design, the power range can be easily adapted. They share the same disadvantages as the Stirling engines, but as I said before, improvements and cost reductions are expected in the future.
Okay. And once stakeholder analysis and study of state of art are performed, the next step is the concept selection. This concept selection needs a list of criteria that are defined according defined clustering the requirements already described. Then these criteria are weighted according to their relevance. And finally, all the technology gets a score for each criterion. The solution with the highest score is the best one. Before to go on with the selection, a techno-economic analysis must be performed. The tool adopted for this techno-economic analysis is a MATLAB code that contains both an energy and economic analysis. The energy part is a linear dynamic model based on energy conservation equation. It behaves like an integral calculator that, starting from daily profile, it provides us integral quantities such as annual consumption. In the economic part, the payback time is computed in the simplified way because the goal here is to perform a quick and comparative study, not a deep design of each machine. In the model, there are three kinds of input data. Technological data that are efficiency, electrical and thermal, size, and rate of change of the output. Then we have economic data. We have cost of technology, cost of maintenance, and energy tariff. And finally, the most important, the load profile. This load profile is a minute by minute daily profile of electrical energy, thermal energy, and domestic hot water. This profile refers to a typical day in a specified season of the year. And they are taken from a German project about the use of micro cogeneration in a residential application. In this slide, we can see an example of the output of the model. In red, the machine, that in this example is the fuel cell, tries to follow the load profile according to its rate of change of the output. Then the model computes the integral quantities in detail, annual consumption and production of thermal energy and electricity, and selling of electricity. And finally, it computes monetary annual savings and payback time. Micro-cogeneration is a very interesting solution, but with the current state of the art, it is not sustainable at all. So how to understand which is the most suitable solution if none of them are actually sustainable? So a different approach is needed, a different strategy is needed. So the point is, if none of them are sustainable, then which are the conditions for which microcogeneration becomes sustainable? Let's pretend that cogeneration is supported by national subsidy, assuming the supporting scheme of photovoltaics as a benchmark. In that case, the most suitable solution is the one that needs the smallest subsidy to become competitive. Then the strategy is try to identify which is the solution that needs the smallest subsidy to reach a payback time of 10 years. This calculation is repeated for four different values of capital cost. With capital cost number one, that means current cost to 2015, the internal combustion engine needs the smallest amount of subsidy, then fuel cell, and then steam engine. But with the cost of 6,000 euro per kilowatt, this cost number three, the green curve, the fuel cell needs the smallest amount of subsidy, then internal combustion, and then steam engine. Assuming that in the next 10, 15 years, the microcogeneration will reach a fully commercialization, we can assume that the cost will decrease below 4 to 6,000 euro per kilowatt. So that the result of this techno-economic analysis is that fuel cell is the most promising solution. Now we have concluded the techno-economic analysis. So we can define a grade, a score, for each criteria, for each solution. The results are summarized in this table, from which we can see, and from this graph, we can see that fuel cell is the most promising solution. It is the result of the entire multi-criteria analysis. Now we can summarize the entire project. We have performed a multi-criteria analysis in order to select the most suitable solution to become an alternative to standard energy supply for small houses. The first point is that with current state of art, the micro CHP is not feasible. So great investment, great research, and probably a supporting scheme by governments are needed. The second point is that the multi-criteria analysis says that the fuel cell is the most promising solution. And the fuel cell is a technology that is coherent with the next house generation, that for sure will have a smaller thermal consumption because the thermal properties of the building will be improved. And we'll have more and more electrical appliances, so that electrical consumption will increase, shifting the consumption from thermal to electrical. And that's why fuel cell is interesting, because it produces much more electricity than heat. Last comment about the model. For sure, the result of the multi-criteria analysis is a good result of the entire project. But more important is the tool through which we have reached this result. This tool is a MATLAB code that has some assumptions. But provided we can accept these assumptions, this model is a very useful, fast, and flexible tool to perform quick and comparative study of different CHP solutions. Thank you for your attention.